Penguin Random House Audio presents Judgment at Tokyo, World War II on Trial and the Making of Modern Asia by Gary J. Bass. Read for you by Simon Vance. For Miriam. Where do murderers go, man? Who's to doom when the judge himself is dragged to the bar? Herman Melville, Moby Dick. Introduction. Tojo Hideki heard the soldiers coming for him. At his simple cottage in Tokyo's suburbs on September 11, 1945, he was making no attempt to hide. With his fastidiously cropped moustache, bald head, round tortoiseshell glasses, and the assertive bearing of a career general, the Prime Minister of Imperial Japan during much of World War II was unmistakable. His grotesquely caricatured features, eyes slanted, teeth sharpened, fingernails pointy, had been a staple of American propaganda, encouraging war bonds, routinely paired with Adolf Hitler and Benito Mussolini. It was just over a month since the detonation of the two atomic bombs, and less than a month since Japan had at last surrendered. The victorious Allied armies were in the early, uncertain days of their occupation of Japan. One of their first tasks was to round up suspected Japanese war criminals. Tojo was perfectly aware that US troops knew where to find him. The day before, an American WAR reporter had had little difficulty locating him at home. When asked who was responsible for starting the war, the Prime Minister whose cabinet had ordered the attack on Pearl Harbor was unrepentant. "You are the victors, and you are able to name him now," he replied serenely. "But historians 500 or 1,000 years from now may judge differently." A small, nervous group of US soldiers arrived at the cottage. At first, Tojo refused to talk to them, and then, dressed casually in an open-collared white shirt, slid open a window to demand their credentials. For some unbearably tense minutes, they were stalled by a servant until their patience wore out. "Tell this yellow bastard we've waited long enough," snapped the US major in charge. Soon after, the Americans heard a muffled gunshot from inside. Startled, the soldiers kicked down the door. They burst into the house to find Tojo standing upright, reeling slightly. In his right hand was a smoking Colt 32 caliber pistol. His left hand was clutched to his chest, red blood streaming through his white shirt. He had made the efficient choice of a gun to kill himself, and an American made one at that, instead of availing himself of any one of the three ceremonial Japanese swords in the room. The leading US major, in the sights of the lurching pistol, screamed, "Don't shoot!" And Tojo let his gun fall with a clatter. Knees buckling, he crumpled into an easy chair. His eyes drooped, and he strained to breathe, sweating, coughing, moaning in agony. Expert at dealing out death, Tojo botched his own. The bullet only grazed his heart, exiting his back at the left shoulder blade. American soldiers, one of them a Japanese-American from the Bronx, bustled him out of the cottage and into a car, and raced him toward an American military hospital at Yokohama, south of central Tokyo. They drove through a shattered, charred landscape. 6 months ago, as many as 100,000 people in Tokyo had been, in the words of a US general leading a massive incendiary bombardment, scorched and boiled and baked to death in a single night. The city's rivers had boiled, and liquefied glass had rained. The stench of burning flesh had been so intense that US B-29 bomber pilots several thousand feet above had gagged. What was left was a vast city of ashes. Much of Japan's sprawling capital had been built with wood houses. Those humble homes were now fine cinders. Tokyo was reduced to a series of shanties, endless rows of little shacks cobbled together from whatever scraps of metal or stone had survived the unnatural flames. The gloom was broken only by the occasional flower planted by the dispossessed residents of these huts, or a curtain hung over a makeshift window. scoured by fire, sturdier buildings like factories were a mangled mess of steel girders. There were colossal piles of rubble strewn around trashed streets. Tokyo was dark, filthy, and collapsing. It reeked. With every kind of infrastructure systematically wrecked by the bombings, there were urgent shortages of every kind: electricity, heat, food, water. The despairing residents were left burned, broken, scarred, bereaved, unwashed, ill-clothed, and underfed. Tojo flickered between life and death. At the Yokohama hospital, a U.S. Army surgeon was unimpressed by the dire chest wound. He had seen hundreds of them. Lying on a simple cot, his shirt and trousers drenched in his own blood, the former Prime Minister grimaced in pain, groaning as he drew breath. Japanese and American doctors stitched him up and gave him plasma infusions. American soldiers watched his agonies with cool indifference. One shrugged that Tojo had earned himself a Purple Heart. Pulling through, he grew strong enough to lament that death was taking so long. He had meant to finish himself off with a single shot, he explained, rather than risking the delay of ritual disembowelment. He had chosen not to shoot himself in the head, he whispered to an interpreter, so that people could recognize his features and know that he was dead. Neither the fact of defeat, nor the devastation of his country, nor a fresh bullet hole through his chest were enough to make him question the rightness of his cause. The Greater East Asia War was a justified and righteous war, waged by Japan to free its Asian neighbors from the oppressive grip of European colonialism, he declared in what he hoped would be his deathbed statement. He expressed his regrets to the Japanese nation and all the races of the greater Asiatic powers, although not to the Allied countries against which his cabinet had gone to war. Given the ruin all around him, he was not inclined to apologize to the bombers. "I would not like to be judged in front of a conqueror's court," Tojo said. "I wait for the righteous judgment of history." This book is about that conqueror's court and the judgment of history. For 2.5 years after his failed suicide, Tojo and 27 other top Japanese wartime leaders were prosecuted by the Allies as war criminals, a trial that is the Asian counterpart to the more famous International War Crimes Tribunal at Nuremberg. The Tokyo trial was a monumental accounting for the personal fates of Tojo and the other powerful Japanese defendants, who were viewed not just as defeated foes to be neutralized, but as criminals accused of aggression and atrocity. Its unfolding drew in a host of household names, including Harry Truman, Emperor Hirohito, Chiang Kai-shek, Jawaharlal Nehru, Douglas MacArthur, and more, as well as lesser-known figures whose richly multifaceted life stories encompass much of their country's modern histories. Mei Zhuo, the cerebral, purposeful Chinese judge hoping to restore his war-torn country. Togo Shigenori, the peace-minded Japanese foreign minister who had struggled to prevent Pearl Harbor, yet wound up on trial as a Class A war criminal. Radabinod Pal, the erudite Indian judge who is today a national icon in Japan, for writing a blistering dissent that acquitted Tojo and all the defendants while denouncing the court itself as illegitimate. It was, as the judges liked to call it, the biggest trial of the world. In a vast, echoing courtroom illuminated with sweltering Klieg lights, the black-robed judges listened to the anguished testimony of Chinese survivors of the Nanjing massacre, heard nightmarish accounts of how British and Australian prisoners of war were worked to death in Thailand and Burma, recoiled at gruesome stories of Filipino civilians who had been bayoneted, beaten, tortured, and raped, eavesdropped on the secret plans being devised for aggression at Pearl Harbor, and gawped at the disgraced last Qing Emperor of China, Puyi, who wound up as a star witness. As the Chinese judge wrote, "In my opinion, the Tokyo trial, like the Nuremberg trial, should also be considered as the greatest thing that comes out from this world war," to borrow a phrase of President Truman. World War II was a war of atrocity, both in Europe and Asia. It is commonplace in wartime to denounce the bestial immorality of the enemy, but in the Pacific War, the question of war crimes was fundamental. The war was defined in Allied minds by Japanese-inflicted horrors. The death march of Filipino and American prisoners of war at Bataan, the captive Australians who perished while building the Burma-Thailand Railway, the sack of Manila. More Australians died from being imprisoned by the Japanese.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.